Good morning and welcome to Exeter BFC. If it is your first time joining us today, we're really glad that you're here and we would like to connect with you. There's a few ways that we can do that. One of them can be found on the seat back in front of you. There's a card that has two QR codes on one side and a form on the other side. If you scan one of those QR codes, it'll take you directly to our online version of that newcomer form, and you can fill that out online, or you can flip that card over and fill out the back of it to let us know that you were here today. After the service is over, make sure that you stop by the welcome desk, which is downstairs, if you haven't already done that, because we have a gift that we'd like to give you to say thanks for joining us today.
All right, everyone, our annual chili cook-off and cornhole tournament is 1 week from today. So next Sunday, October 8th at 5 p.m. right here at the church, over in the gymnasium and the cafeteria, we will have our yearly event. If you are hoping to play cornhole, the deadline for registering your team is today. So be sure to talk to Sean McAnulty or sign up today in the e-bulletin or on the paper sheet in either lobby. But we do need time this week to put together the bracket. So if you don't sign your team up today, you won't be able to play cornhole. If you plan to just come and eat chili and hang out and enjoy watching the cornhole, there's no need to sign up. You're welcome to bring a side dish or a dessert if you like. If you do plan to enter the chili cook-off, we would ask if you're able to sign up for that ahead of time, just so we know how to plan accurately there. One more thing to note, the chili cook-off and the cornhole tournament will take the place of our normal Sunday evening service. So there is no Sunday evening service next week because we will be doing the chili cook-off and the cornhole tournament event.
This is an announcement that might be for some of you newcomers, as well as some of those of you who have been attending here for years. We have a membership class that happens every so often, which is really the best way for you to figure out whether or not you want to become a member here at Exeter BFC. You might have some specific questions about doctrine or some of the things that kind of happen on a week-to-week basis that really makes Exeter BFC tick. And we'd also like to give you information on how you can partner along with us as members here at Exeter BFC. That membership class is happening October 15th, right after the service, and there'll be some light snacks as Pastor Bill works his way through a lot of the doctrine and membership qualifications here at Exeter BFC. If you're interested, make sure that you sign up either in our upper lobby, lower lobby at the welcome desk, or in our e-bulletin to let us know that you plan on attending. Every first Tuesday of the month, our men's Bible study is happening here at the church, and that's coming up this October 3rd, Tuesday night at 6:15. There's no need to sign up for this Bible study or anything like that. We'd just love to see you here Tuesday night at 6:15. If you have any specific questions about that men's study, you can speak with Nate Arndt or Andrew Eichelberg.
Those are all the announcements we have for this week, though we do like to invite you to check out our e-bulletin, and you can do that by scanning the QR code on the card in the seat in front of you, or by visiting www.exeterbfc.org/bulletins, where you can either view the bulletin each week, or you can actually sign up to receive the bulletin directly to your email each week. Be sure to check that out for all different kinds of things, including many volunteer opportunities. For example, we always need people to help in our children's ministry. We have a greeter welcome team ministry that could use some more volunteers, a food pantry ministry, care team. All those announcements can be found in this week's e-bulletin, and it's a great way to get involved and get plugged in at the church. At this time, we invite you to stand and greet your neighbor before we continue in worship.
Full use of keyboard.
Good morning again, everybody. I hope that you are awake and ready to worship with us. We're going to start with a familiar song to open things up with the Lion and the Lamb, and I want us just to recognize that that is who our God is, that he can be the great and mighty Father, but he can also be that one who comforts and heals. And as we even continue with the first couple songs, we'll move into that, that he is the way maker, and he continually moves in us and through us for his glory and his alone. Amen. So, if you would remain standing, let's start in worship. Sing the first verse.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He is roaring with power and fighting our battles.
Stop.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
we continue in worship through Waymaker, we are going to make those declarations that nothing can overcome our God. We're actually going to go to the chorus there. I'm slightly distracted. Let's pick up from the chorus. You are Waymaker, miracle worker.
You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. Worship you, I worship you.
You are here.
You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working, you never stop, you never stop working, you never stop, you never stop.
I want to remind ourselves,
even when I don't see it, you're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working, you never stop working, you never stop. Never stop working.
One last time.
When I don't see it, you're working.
Good morning. As the ushers come forward for the morning offering, before we pray, I just want to share a few verses. The past few weeks, I've been reading through a book called The Preeminent Christ, and these verses kind of stuck out to me. It's 1 Corinthians 1:28-2:2. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And we have no forgiveness of sins and no redemption without Christ and his death on the cross. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to gather together today as a church body. We thank you for the chance to come before you in prayer and in worship to hear your word preached. Lord, we thank you for the chance that we have to fellowship, to encourage one another, and to encourage each other, Lord, to just spend time talking to each other, Lord. Let us always be a church that lifts each other up in prayer and in you, Lord. Lord, I pray for those who can't be with us this morning, Lord, those who may be sick, those who physically can't be here. I pray for your peace and strength for them this morning. Lord, we pray specifically for Shar and Jerry Dibler. I pray that as they are both in separate rehabs, Lord, we pray for continued recovery and strength. Help them to look to you as they are going through this time. Lord, this morning we think of our missionaries, for those who are serving you here at home and abroad. Lord, we thank you for your word, which is being shared and preached this morning. Lord, we pray for wisdom, for strength, and for protection. Lord, we thank you for the chance that we have to serve you right here in our community. We thank you for the food pantry yesterday, for a chance to share your love to those in our community and to help those who are in need. And Lord, this morning we think of the Hope Rescue Mission. We thank you for the amazing work that they do for the homeless men in the city of Reading. Thank you for the shelter, for the meals that they provide for these men and for everything else, Lord. And most importantly, we thank you for your word, which is shared with all these men. I pray that the gospel of Christ and his death on the cross for our sins will continue to be preached there for years to come. Lord, we thank you for the new women's and children's shelter, which is being completed. Lord, we pray that you will use this shelter in the same way that you have used the men's shelter. Lord, this is such a needed and an amazing thing, and we thank you for all those who helped to make it happen. Lord, we thank you this morning for Rob Turchi, who is with us this morning, to share your word. And Lord, this morning, I pray for our church. Lord, I pray for myself. I pray for every person who is here or is at home. Lord, help us to never leave our first love for Christ. Help us to make knowing you the most important thing in our lives. We know that without your work on the cross, there is no forgiveness of sins. There is no salvation apart from you. And Lord, this morning we thank you for the gospel and for your love for us. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
As those containers are being passed, it's also time to dismiss our older kids to their classrooms downstairs. So in a nice and orderly fashion, kids, if you don't mind meeting your teacher in the back, and make sure you stay together as you head down to your classrooms. We'll give them just a moment to make their way to the back before we stand together again as a congregation, worship through song with wonderful, merciful Savior. So if you're able, please stand and join us as we sing.
Skill the souls.
the one. Take just a quick moment here to introduce our guest speaker that we have with us this morning. I know he's already been mentioned in Andrew's prayer, but specifically we're being joined by Rob Turchi from Hope Rescue Mission. And I had a specific bio that I was going to read, but now my device is being finicky, so I'm just going to give him the chance to go ahead and walk on up here as we give him a warm welcome and thank him for coming and preaching and speaking to us about his mission and what he's been called to do by God in this specific area of Pennsylvania. So let's welcome him and give him thanks for being here.
Good morning. Thank you, brother. And really, my bio is not all that exciting, so you didn't miss out on that much. But if you want to know more about me, I suppose you'll have to talk to me after. But my name is Rob Turchi, and I have really had the honor of serving the Lord at Hope Rescue Mission for the past 13 years. So it dawned on me I've been there 10% of the lifespan of the ministry, because the mission has been in Reading for 130 years. So I've survived 10%. I thought that was kind of interesting. And this was actually one of the first churches that I visited 13 years ago when I joined the staff of the mission. So I have a lot of memories from coming here every few years. I believe it's been maybe 3 or 4 years since I've been here last. But the sanctuary looks great. Everything sounds great. You all look so wonderful. And so it's just neat to see some of the new things going on, but especially the new faces. If you have not been to the mission, I just welcome you to come check it out. Usually when people come to the mission for the first time, they say, wow, I didn't know there was so much going on. I pictured kind of a smaller ministry, but this place is so much bigger. There's so much more going on. I just didn't realize. So I would just encourage you. I mean, I'll share a few things, but I just really welcome you to come take a tour, check it out. There's something special that happens beyond just hearing about it or even hearing me talk about it and seeing some slides. I think when you go there and you see the scale of the need in Reading, which is just a couple miles away, and you see the people, and it's not a dark, dreary place. It's a place filled with light and love in the midst of darkness in people's lives. So I think that God will stir something in your heart if you come and check it out. But as was mentioned, the mission's been around in Reading as a place of refuge for men to come to in the darkest times of their lives. It would be great if men came to us and said, life is going great, and I'm here to celebrate, and I want to learn more about Jesus, and I'm just here at a great time in my life. But the reality is, men come to the mission when they're out of other options, when they have nowhere else to go, when they maybe are victims of just crazy life circumstances, or they're victims of just some really terrible choices that they've made and kind of shipwrecked their own lives. So men come in times of need and darkness. But it's such a strategic opportunity because we, of course, offer men all the physical provisions that they need, a safe place to stay, food, shelter, clothing, toiletries, personal care items, you know, the things that maybe you and I on a daily basis take for granted. But in addition to that, what's really special about the mission is we don't just take care of men physically. We really encourage them to think about their greater spiritual needs. So we don't want men to be homeless in this life, but even more so, we don't want men to be homeless in the next life. So that's why men can come with any belief system or no belief system, but we share who they are, who Christ is, and really what we believe is their greatest spiritual needs. So it's very strategic. And we have, I could talk for the entire time about the ministry. And maybe that would be more comfortable for you and maybe more comfortable for me, but I'm just going to give you a couple of highlights. So, and I might need Dwayne to help me out with advancing slides. Oh, give you the secret one. Let's go back one. So men come and find a temporary home and a time of fellowship. And you know, we, the staff and volunteers come in and we try to minister as much as we can in men's time of need. But I'll tell you, something very special also happens when men build up relationships, connections, ministry in and amongst themselves. What I think is special is that there are men that have come through the front doors and have worked their way through our various phases of residential programs, and they're doing well, and they're saving up to transition out of the mission, and they have grown in all areas of their lives. That's very special for them to be around as a resource and as a motivation for the guys first coming in. Because I, as the director of the mission, can tell guys first coming in, listen, this is what I think you need to do. This is what you need to not do. This is the path that you should walk. But if a man who has come up those 19 front steps a few months before and has lived a lot of the same life patterns as the guys just coming in, says the very same things, it's almost like he has more license to speak into men's lives. Especially if you have older men speaking to younger men and saying, listen, young brother, you don't want to keep going down this path, okay? I have spent half of my adult life, you know, in and out of jail. I hope for something better for you. So there's also just a very great ministry that happens in and amongst the men. A couple of highlights, updates since I've been here last that I wanted to focus on, just two. And that is the partnership that we have with many different ministries, but one very strategic. We've had a long-term partnership with Pennsylvania Adult and Teen Challenge, and we have sent men. They've been the place that we prefer to send men to when they're in active addiction. Men can come to the mission in active addiction, but they can't stay in active addiction. They have to be willing to pursue a recovery plan. Not just talk about it, but pursue it and walk that walk. So now Teen Challenge is on site full-time through what's called a Naaman Center. And the Naaman Center occupies three offices on our top floor. And we have full-time Pennsylvania Adult and Teen Challenge that we essentially direct men right away to when they come in and if they come up positive for some kind of narcotic in their system. They can be fast-tracked to inpatient detox and rehab if needed. And then if they choose to come back to the mission, they can continue to meet with Naaman Center staff for individual and group counseling. So that's just a really wonderful on-site partnership that we have now. The other thing I wanted to mention is for all these years, the mission has been a wonderful place for men to come to, right, and to get back up on their feet and to connect with the Lord. But we've noticed over the last several years, it's increasingly difficult for men to have a successful transition out of the mission. I mean, a lot of times guys say, boy, I haven't felt this good. Nobody wants to come to the mission, right? I mean, it's a last resort. But often men say, I haven't felt this good in like so many years. I've really been able to make progress. I've had more stability, more connection, more encouragement, more family atmosphere, more love. I've been able to walk a road of recovery, and things are going well. But even in Reading, financially, things are difficult. To find an affordable place to live, guys, you know, maybe 6, 7, 8 years ago would go and rent an apartment or a single home in Reading, a row home for, you know, $500-$600. Now that might be $1,200. So we have launched a new program this summer called Hope Houses. And what it is off-site transitional housing. Another wonderful ministry named Freedom Gate closed down their ministry, and part of doing so, they donated properties to us in Reading off-site. So now what we're doing is we are giving faithful men who have done well in our programs the opportunity to move off-site and to have a next step toward independence, but to continue to save up while living off-site in a supportive group home type environment. So we're very excited about that. There's lots of different ways that you could get involved in the men's side, but as I gave a little sneak preview to, and if you get our newsletters, you know, the largest ministry expansion in 130 years is called the Lighthouse Women and Children's Center. We took a 10,000 square foot thrift store and another 15,000 square foot connected warehouse for donation processing and turned it into a homeless hotel, if you will. Unlike the men's side, there's no congregant living. Women and children do not stay in a dormitory, which is oftentimes, you know, why moms won't go to other area shelters. They don't know what it's going to be like having their children sleeping near or using a restroom with people that they don't know, and they're not sure what their life problems are. So the Lighthouse consists of 43 private suites. And it's interesting, we've had different college students over the summer helping us set up things, and some of the college student feedback is like, man, this is way nicer than my dorm room. My college costs like 60 grand a year. Half of the building is set up for single women. And this picture is a depiction of what a single woman's room might look like. What you don't see is a fridge, freezer, microwave, little kitchenette there off to the right. And then also a full bathroom. So each suite has a full bathroom with the full shower and everything. The other half of the building is set up with bunk beds and different, you know, flex furniture depending on what a family needs. That might be for mom and a couple of kids. So no one is in a congregant area. No children will be using a restroom with any strangers. So that's very important. That was really on our hearts to provide that kind of dignity and privacy. We don't want children staying at the Lighthouse to ever even feel like they're at a homeless shelter. We want them, from the moment they come into the Lighthouse, to feel safe, secure, clean, dignified, loved. And, you know, in 13 years of being involved in the men's ministry, the reality is when men come to us, they're in great brokenness. And man, they've been through so much trauma. So the men's side is a lot of times like trying to put broken pieces back together through the healing of the power of the Holy Spirit. But what our desire really is for Lighthouse is to have children come in and be able to come to know the Lord and who they are and his plans for their lives and their identity in Christ as young as possible, just like you guys are doing even right now. You have faithful people working in the children's ministry rooms right now to bring up children in that path. And what we're hoping is that that will not be putting broken pieces back together, but to avoid children having to go through that kind of trauma and brokenness, which can oftentimes just kind of stay with them the rest of their lives and really affect them in their adulthood. We're hoping that it will be trauma reducing and trauma preventing, that children will be safer than ever coming to the Lighthouse. And then when they're 18-year-olds, if they come back to the mission, they can come as disciples of Christ ministering to others instead of in brokenness and homelessness with nowhere else to go. Well, as I said, I could spend the whole time just talking about the ministry. And that might be comfortable for you, and certainly comfortable for me. But I was given this time, and not a lot of direction. I was told I could preach on whatever I want, share on whatever I want. So although, you know, coming as a visitor from another ministry, I could just kind of like talk to you all about it. And then at the end of the service, you could say, that's great. That's wonderful what the Lord is doing through those people over there at that ministry. I presume that you have different people coming from other organizations or maybe missionaries from other countries. And it's a nice transfer of ministry information. And you all can sit there and look so lovely as you do and receive the information about what's going on. And then you can leave and go home and maybe not necessarily be challenged to do anything about this transfer of ministry information. And that's not really what I want to do. I really want to try to challenge you, encourage you, shake you up a bit. Don't get me wrong, I'd love to talk about the mission, and I encourage you to come check it out if you haven't been there. But what I really want to do is try to get to the heart of something that maybe won't just be so passive for you to receive, but will be a challenge to you. I have the honor of speaking at a lot of different churches on behalf of the mission. And something that really dawns on me, and you may be here, and I don't know if your leaders challenge you in this way, but what is our motivation to serve? Is it true here at Exeter? I don't know what the percentage is, but some people say that like 20% of the congregants do 80% of the work. So I just wonder, like, you know, those are up leading music worship, those who are doing Sunday schools, those who are doing all the different, you know, leadership and all, are they involved in like multiple different ministries? Like if you need something done, do you think of the people who are already really busy, overwhelmed with other ministry? And then the vast majority of the people who, again, you look so lovely and you look so wonderful, don't get me wrong, but I wonder if the majority of people just kind of come as if you're going to see a show, as if you're being entertained, you know, maybe a pew potato type, where you're not really actively engaged in the ministry, but you just come, maybe watch the paid professionals do the ministry, and you cheer them on and you wish them well, but it's like you're an audience in the stands. I think that's a really terrible way for us to exist as followers of Christ. Because really, and there's been, you know, all these neat, catchy books written about it, but none of us should really be a fan of ministry. None of us should merely just, you know, drop a check in the offering plate and just encourage those and thank, which you should. You should thank those, your leaders. But we need to be in the game and realize that Christ calls us all to be in the game. That we exist not to just encourage the ministry of others, but to realize whether you're in full-time vocational ministry or not, you are called to serve the kingdom of God in the place and around the people that he has you just as much as anybody up here on the platform. So that's really the heart of what I want to share. And the title of this morning's message is Eternal Dividends from Matthew 6, verses 19 to 21. Eternal dividends. So before we jump into it, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this church and for the longevity of ministry to the community. I don't know all the individuals here, so if I say something that is challenging or maybe a bit offensive to somebody, I pray that they wouldn't hold it against me, but realize I don't know where they're at in their service to you. So I pray that you would help us to be challenged, stirred up. Help us not to just file this message away in our spiritual filing cabinet of just another message we listen to, and then we go home and don't do anything about it. I have the unique opportunity to speak on your behalf here. This is your local church once every few years. So I just pray that you would open up our minds, open up our hearts, and help us to be challenged, and help us to be just poked by your Holy Spirit to do something about what you teach in these verses. So I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. I was joking with Dale. Dale, where are you? Dale in here? Hey! Dale said, you better keep it interesting before I doze off. Yeah. So I said, well, I'll tell you what, brother. I promise you I'll give the primary main point of the message early on, so that way if you do doze off, at least you get it. All right? So the primary takeaway is this. Lying in your casket, only your heavenly IRA will pay dividends. That's going to keep you awake at least a little bit longer, I hope. Brothers and sisters, you and I have an appointment with a casket or a wooden box or an urn full of ashes or whatever you decide once your time. You, our hearts are going to stop beating. We're going to take our last breath at some point in time. And when you really think about life and the older you get, you realize just what a quick vapor we have here down on earth. Such a short time. And I believe that you and I, we get so distracted with our short time on earth. We invest in so many different things here in life. And I'm not saying they're bad, sinful things, right? But we get so preoccupied with so many things of life. And I think it's sometimes interesting for us to think about the end of our life and then the life to come and God's kingdom and heaven, which a lot of times we don't think about because it's spooky, scary. We're just glad that we're going to be there, but it's just almost like, well, I hope I have as much time on earth here because I'm not looking forward to it because it's kind of weird and spiritual and I don't understand it, but I believe it will be good, way better than here. But we really need to think about after our time is done, we breathe that last breath, what really is going to matter in the time that we've had down here? And I believe is what the heart of what Jesus is speaking to us in Matthew 6, just a couple verses, 19 through 21. And I need to make sure that I have it because I definitely can't read it back there. So let me pull it up here as well. Maybe 13 years ago, if I came and spoke, I could see that back screen, but now I'm going to need to view it up here. Jesus teaches us, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where the thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You're, I'm sure, very familiar with these verses. You probably taught on these verses, right? Jesus is telling us, he's encouraging us, he's instructing us to be wise investors. He's saying, lay up treasures in heaven. He's saying to lay up, store up, build up, accumulate. He's encouraging you to invest in your heavenly IRA. And the original language, whoa, I didn't do that. I guess it's a sign that I was taking too long and I really need to be done, so let's just pray and sing. No. He's telling us to accumulate these treasures in heaven. And the original language has this idea that each one of us has this treasure room, this treasure chest, this storage thing where thieves can't break in and they won't like get moldy or rusty. Nothing can cause them to like diminish or you know like go down in value. As you invest, let's say you accumulate things in this life, they're temporary and they're not necessarily secure, right? They could be taken away just as quickly as you accumulated them. Somebody could steal them. You could just make some bad choices and lose them. And so Jesus is saying, if you invest in things in that life, they're much more secure and eternal and not subject to the risks of what you have down here in this life. So we would call someone who invests in their earthly IRA, their retirement, wise, right? I mean, hopefully you're making decisions early on in your career to put something away. I think we all look forward to a time in our life when we don't necessarily have to work full time, but we have the means to be able to pay our bills and, I don't know, whatever you want out of retirement. Maybe you just want to be financially secure. You don't need lots, but you just don't want to have to work full time. Hopefully it's that you can be super extra devoted into the ministry here at the local church or parachurch organizations. Maybe you want more. Maybe you want to have a huge earthly retirement, so that you can travel the world and drive a nice car and be super generous to Exeter Bible Fellowship Church and super generous to God's work at Hope Rescue Mission financially. I don't know, whatever it is you want out of your earthly IRA. We would call someone who prepares well for that stage of life, if you make it that long, wise, wouldn't we not? How much more wise is it, and Jesus is imploring us to do this, to even have more focus on investing in your heavenly IRA or the treasures of heaven, which you'll enjoy forever. I mean, some people, they do a really wise job of storing up an earthly IRA, and then it just goes to other people, right? I mean, they breathe their last breath before they retire. They've built up this nest egg and somebody else enjoys it. Nobody can steal your heavenly IRA. That's the good news. Whatever you build up for the kingdom of God here, it won't be passed on to somebody else. You'll get to enjoy it, not the kids. Different scriptures give the idea of a promised reward. So we're told in these scriptures that if we give to the needy and pray and fast in the right way, not as a show for other people, but in secret, we'll be rewarded by God. If we endure insults and persecution for following him, we're told that there will be a reward. If we follow and teach others to follow Jesus' commands, we'll be called greater. Do you know where we'll be called greater? Greater in heaven. That's awfully strange. And conversely, we're told if we don't do these things, we'll be called lesser in heaven. That's a weird one. We'll come back to it. We're told loving our enemies. Again, there's a promised reward in heaven. And if we are caring for fellow believers, especially new converts, there is a reward. So I'd like to put before you a case study, if you will. Two men who lived and had encounters with Jesus, and I'd like us to just make some observations about them and their lives and their conversion. This case study is the Apostle Paul and the thief on the cross. Both men had encounters with Jesus, right? Both men came to know that they needed something from Jesus and are in heaven with him now. The Apostle Paul, we obviously know the road that he was on. I mean, literally the road to Damascus, doing certain things that he thought were honoring to God, which were actually the opposite, and persecuting God and his people. And he had this dramatic conversion that totally transformed his life, turned him in a 180-degree direction, so that he did the opposite of what he was doing before. Instead of persecuting and seeking out and hunting down Christians, God used him to write at least half of the New Testament, to spread the gospel to the Gentile world, to be shipwrecked, beaten, flogged, rejected by his people, by men, bitten, you know, just terrible. He must have had all these battle scars, physically suffering, but yet enduring these missionary journeys to spread the gospel. And he was blessed with years of opportunity to serve the Lord. So then conversely, how about the guy on the cross at Jesus' side? That when they went up on the cross next to each other, at first the scripture tells us that he started out mocking Jesus. And then something happened, thanks be to God, that before he breathed his last breath, he realized that there was something special about this guy, and to the extent that he could understand, God extended grace to him so that he could realize his need for reconciliation with God through this Messiah, through this guy on the cross next to him. So he called out and asked that Jesus would please remember him, and Jesus gave him a promise that he would be with him in the next life, even in paradise that day. If you have an unsaved family member, I mean, the last hope that we hold out to is that they would have a deathbed conversion. We don't want it to wait that long. We want somebody to come to know the Lord as early and quickly and soon as possible in their life. But the minimum we'll take, of course, is for them before they run out of time, before their heart stops beating and they breathe that last breath, that they realize that they're a broken sinner, an enemy of God, and they need something that they can't effectuate for themselves, that Jesus has already done for them, and they need to turn to him and call out to him by grace through faith. Does it really matter if you get saved earlier and serve the Lord in these profound, amazing ways, or if you just get saved in the nick of time and go to heaven? Is there an advantage? Did Paul have an advantage? Was Paul extra blessed more than the thief on the cross? Although, thank God he had mercy on him right before he died. Was there any benefit to all that faithful, zealous suffering and persecution that Paul endured to serve the Lord in the time he had on earth? Is there real great significance between the cross and the grave? We were all born, right? So We all, you know, come into this world and we have our physical birth. Then hopefully we realize at some point in time that we need to be reborn, and we come to the foot of the cross and we are converted through the work of Christ that we couldn't earn on our own. And then we are spiritually born. And then the next phase, which we know is called glorification, is the grave, when we're done this physical life. And then that's when we truly live and the best is yet to come. But is there great significance between the cross and the grave and how we live? Does it really matter if you live a faithful, fruit-producing, spirit-fueled, spirit-yielding, kingdom-focused, missionary type of life, whether you're in full-time vocational ministry or not? Or is it fine to just come to Exeter Bible Fellowship, be a faithful church attender, try to avoid some major big bad sins in your life, and then look forward to going to heaven based on what Jesus did, and that's enough for you? Folks, I think a lot of times we mistakenly look at conversion as the finish line. Like, for our family, for our friends, for our children. Don't get me wrong, I'm the father of four teenage boys. My heart, deepest heart, is yearning is that they will be saved. But I think that we erroneously look at our experience in life or others' experience in life as like that's the goal. And that's an amazing goal that we can't make happen to them. It has to be a work, obviously, of the Holy Spirit. But when you get saved, okay, so then what? You're just kind of in a holding pattern until you go to heaven? And how you live doesn't really matter because you're covered with the get-out-of-jail-free card and you have the grace of God. You'll never lose it. You didn't earn it. You'll never lose it. So whatever heaven's going to be like, we're happy to just know that we're going to be a citizen of heaven. I think that conversion spiritually is the starting line, not the finish line. I think that's when the good stuff starts. And I think a lot of times we just live these passive Christian lives that we know we got saved 58 years ago, and we're happy and secure in our salvation, and we're not really looking for much more out of this time on earth than when he calls us home and we're happy to go up, not down. But I want to tell you this morning, I truly believe, and I believe Jesus is teaching us, that heaven is not a socialist commune. Don't get me wrong. I am just happy that because of what Christ did for me, I have the opportunity to spend eternity in his kingdom, which I will believe will be absolutely amazing. No human words could truly capture it, but we get these pictures, these ideas. But I think a lot of times we think, well, since I didn't earn, and no man or woman could ever earn their way into heaven, we're just happy to have the opportunity to go to heaven. And we almost kind of picture it, if we're real, that despite whatever life you lived, you go to heaven and everybody just has the same experience, right? I don't think that's biblical. I think just as you and I sang these songs to the Lord, there was these various different degrees of connection and intimacy with the Lord. Now, before I go any further, let me just clarify. I'm not saying that you can get into heaven by any other ways. I'm not saying that how you live, faithfully or unfaithfully, could ever make a difference in whether you get into heaven or not. That is only by grace through faith alone in what Christ did. That's salvation. I'm not trying to preach any variation of any other kind of salvation. But I'm talking about your sanctification process between the cross and the grave. Once Christ, when you receive the free gift that he earned for you, and until you go to his kingdom, I believe the life that you live will drastically impact your experience in heaven. And if that is true, ladies and gentlemen, we better wake up and be wise investors in our heavenly IRA. Because if somebody in their 50s, 60s, 70s says, man, I better start saving some money, they're kind of really ripped themselves off, right? I mean, better late than never. But I think spiritually too, if you have been a passive church attender and not really investing in treasures in heaven, you are ripping yourself off. I'm not saying you're not going to heaven, but I think that you are not being a wise spiritual investor. We're told that believers will be judged and potentially rewarded. Again, not getting into heaven, but the experience of what heaven will be like. So I'd like to challenge you with these verses, which I'm going to have to look here to read. and that is from 2 Corinthians 5, 9-10, in which we're told, "So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." This judgment seat is called the Bema seat. This is not the great white throne where there will actually be condemnation, where unbelievers will be separated from believers. Okay, this is not that kind of judgment. The Bema seat had an understanding from the original readers of this letter to understand a picture that would come in their mind with the Bema seat. And that was like at that time, a few thousand years ago, a judge's seat in the Olympics. So even back then and now, we have the best of the best athletes from every country that go and compete. And based upon their performance, they might earn, I mean, they're just so happy to make it to the Olympics, whether they win a medal or not, but they're truly fighting the good fight. They're running the race in order to try to get the prize. Nobody is told you did terrible, you're kicked out of the Olympics, we condemn you, right? I mean, because they're still the best of the best athletes. But some people, based on their performance, could earn a bronze medal to be honored among the honored athletes of the world. And then at others might be rewarded with a silver medal. And then those who perform the best could be honored on that top of that platform with a gold medal. So how does that relate to rewards in heaven and an earthly IRA? Well, many theologians for many, many years have kind of understood it in this way. You and I have the ability, whether we are focused on living zealously, yielding to the Spirit, being focused on the fruit of the Spirit growing, faithfully serving him, putting him above all other idols, and just trying to seek after him as if an athlete competing for a prize, as the opportunity to increase our capacity for holiness and happiness. So let's go back to Paul and the thief on the cross. On the road to Damascus when Paul was saved, and before he breathed his last breath, the thief on the cross, they had a conversion experience. Before that, they didn't have any spiritual connection with God. They didn't have the capacity for the indwelling, the presence of God. They were disconnected. There was a barrier between them and the holiness and happiness, the glory of God. They weren't in the family. They were enemies. They were cut off from it. Now, that doesn't mean that when someone's cut off from the glory of God, that life is just absolutely miserable and terrible. It will be, but we all still, as citizens of this earth, live under what's called God's common grace. So even if you don't believe that God exists, you can enjoy a beautiful sunrise. You can enjoy a wonderful, juicy steak. Sorry, vegetarians or vegans, and juicy whatever it is that you eat. You can have a family. You can have children. You can have a nice house. You can take a nice vacation. Even if you say that cosmic gases and primordial ooze exploded billions of years ago, and that's how life and eyeballs and love and everything happens, and there's no intelligent designer, there's no creator who cares about a first cause, you just believe that there's nothing out there and you just push up daisies. You still, even if you are a blaspheming denier of God's existence, can still enjoy the common grace of God down here. But when you come to become a son or daughter of God through the gospel of Christ, you not only receive common grace, but you now have this connection with God. You're linked to him that he gave to you as a free gift that nobody can snatch away, nobody can break. No experience on earth, no matter how terrible it is, or spiritual principalities can ever take you away or separate you from the love of Christ once you're intimately, eternally linked to it through salvation. So people have understood that what it means is that, like, Paul and the thief on the cross, they both got, like, I don't know, this filling, like when people say there's a hole in your heart that only God can fill. And maybe we could picture it as when you get saved, you have like a little Dixie cup that's put in your soul. And then when you're saved, God fills it with his holiness and happiness. Okay? okay? And then if you're a thief on the cross and you then immediately go up to heaven, you have the capacity for God's holiness and happiness in your life, in your Dixie cup. And I imagine the thief on the cross a few hours later going up to before God and being so thankful that, boy, by the skin of his teeth, he just made it in. And I believe that when we go up to heaven, our glorification, God takes a full measure of his holiness and happiness, his glory, and he pours it into that Dixie cup. And that thief on the cross or anybody that has a deathbed conversion is filled to the brim. And I believe that they aren't looking around at other people's Dixie cups. They're just feeling so filled. And forever, there's no jealousy. There's no any kind of sin. There's no nothing. There's only enjoying God's glory. And if that's what you're looking forward to, that's wonderful. It'll be great forever and ever, and you'll feel filled to the brim. But really what's at the heart of this message is, did Paul and the thief on the cross go with the same size Dixie cup? Or all that faithful service and persecution and endurance for the gospel, did that make Paul's Dixie cup grow? Folks, I believe that you and I can be saved right here in this room. We all have this unbreakable link to God. And we're going to heaven not because we earned it, but because of what Jesus did for us. But I don't believe that our experience of God, even while singing the songs, is the same. If you live a very passive, lukewarm, unfocused, distracted, filled with all other kinds of pursuits and idols in your life, and God's just a good thing in your life, I don't believe you're growing. So I believe that's when you sing to the Lord and when you serve him, it's at a certain level. Thank God you have that connection with him. But if you are living an on fire, kingdom focused, missional, wise spiritual investing, Christ is your top pursuit, and you realize that despite all the other things in life, your identity as his servant, his ambassador, his workmanship here on this earth is the most important thing to you. I believe that when Paul pulled up to the pearly gates, he didn't have a Dixie cup. I don't know what he had, like a U-Haul, like a shipping container, like a... I believe that he grew his capacity to enjoy the presence of God, the holiness and happiness, the glory of God in this life so much deeper and wider, and that's why he prays. I just pray that your eyes will be enlightened and that you'll realize how deep and wide and everything the love of Christ is for you, and that you will increasingly grow in your connection, your service, not as a show for other people, but as in the secret intimacy of your connection with Christ, your first love, that actually causes your capacity for his glory to grow. And then I believe when Paul got into heaven, the Lord poured in from the same glory cup that he did the thief on the cross. But man, Paul had the capacity for so much more holiness and happiness and glory, and he was filled to the brim. I don't believe that the thief on the cross and Paul are next to each other comparing, saying, why'd you get so much more? I think our eyes are totally focused on God. And some people joke, like my biological father, who lives far away, has always lived far away, he got converted really just a few years ago in his 70s. And I'm so thankful. I prayed for him for so many years. But he oftentimes jokes, he's like, yeah, man, I'm just thankful like for whatever kind of little, you know, flat that I'll have, you know, like some little tiny studio apartment in heaven, and hopefully I'll be able to go to your, like, you know, private gated community in heaven, and, you know, for sure, like, you know, you'll have some mansion. Some of those illustrations are kind of fun, but what if what the real treasure of heaven is God himself? What if the treasure of heaven is not just some golden street, or so you have a fancier type of car, or, you know, you have some bigger mansion, like as if it's something that you could just kind of enjoy for yourself, but what if it's the very glory of God Like, what if you and I are breathing right now between the cross and the grave as an opportunity to grow, even in battling and struggling through sin and serving? Because when we get to heaven, there's no more growth. There's just eternal enjoyment. But what if we have this opportunity to invest in heavenly things? And the real crux of it is the presence and the power and the glory and the holiness and the happiness and the enjoyment and intimacy of God himself in this life and in greater capacity and measure for eternity in the next life. What more important thing could I challenge you with, believers, or you could be focused on investing in? If you're okay with just kind of a passive pal relationship, every once in a while sending a DM to Jesus and every once in a while open a scripture and pray for somebody once in a while and go to church most of the time, and you just, you know, you're good. Like, Jesus is a buddy. You're not selling him short. You're only selling yourself short. Because I believe no matter what you do for a living, no matter if you've gone to Bible college or not, no matter what your background, race, whatever, anything is, if you know Christ, you have this amazing opportunity to grow in this life, faithfully serve him, and I believe it will have a profound impact on the depth and the width in which you can be filled with the glory of God and be called greater in heaven because you have the capacity to enjoy in a deeper way than someone else that just lives this passive existence down here between the cross and the grave. And I suppose that a challenge would be to look for the God moment in every interaction with people and to have an intimate relationship with him when no one else is looking. I mean, if you have no desire to talk to the Lord, open up his scripture, really intimately connect with him when no one else is looking, we really need to ask him to help us realize where we are spiritually. In the same way, as we interact with other people, what's our focus? Do we believe that how we interact and serve the people in the world around us can help us increase our experience of God? Or do other people around us just exist kind of for our benefit? Like, what can I get out of this person, or how can they benefit me or not? You know, I have a friend who goes to a church very close by in Birdsboro, and his name is Mark, and he wouldn't mind me talking about him because he openly shares his testimony to different, you know, youth groups especially, but he's a speaker. And when Mark was a young boy, he had to have surgery to remove a cancerous tumor from his brain, which, if I'm not mistaken, I think was maybe about age 9 or so, and he lost his sight. And he was born into a Christian family. He came to know Jesus before that age. But you know, when he gives a testimony before teenagers who say, wow, I can't imagine what it would be like to be blind, he says, man, I thank Jesus for that tumor. I thank Jesus for that surgery. I thank Jesus for taking away my physical sight. And when you first hear that, you think, oh no, like seeing is so wonderful. But you know what Mark says? He says, I see now better than I ever did before with my sight. He said, because I don't judge anybody anymore because I can't on the way that they look. Folks, I think that you and I get so focused on what we see on the physical realm, before you even talk to somebody, you're already sizing up, judging them and all, have all these external, shallow, very unimportant ways of looking and connecting with someone. Maybe the way that they look, you don't even want to talk to them. Right? I mean, think about the homeless community. A lot of people see them, if they look homeless, oh man, I'm gonna stay away from them. I believe that you and I, there is so much more going on around us, and we are so focused on the physical realm, and we're missing the point. If you and I would just spiritually close our eyes and realize that there is a spiritual realm going on all around us in the lives of everyone we come in contact with. And it's great, come to church, talk about the weather, talk about the Eagles, talk about all the shallow stuff, right? But do we ever get past that? Do we ever spiritually, so to say, close our eyes, hopefully not Dale or anybody else right now before we finish? If you see him, maybe you could bump him. But do we close our physical eyes and ask Christ to open up our spiritual eyes so that we can interact with people around us in a way that will increase our intimacy and connection and the capacity to be filled with the glory of God. I don't know if you guys just leave the chairs up all the time or whether you have different activities, so maybe you stack them and have whatever, you know, certain churches do that, but like stacking the chairs or, and you know, putting them in rows and then putting them back could maybe be one of the most menial things that tasks you do at church. Could there be a God moment in even the minimal things? What's your heart attitude to whatever service toward the Lord? So remembering, as I wrap up here, and I don't know how long it was, so I'm sorry if I went over, but lying in your casket, only your heavenly IRA will pay dividends. Folks, don't cheer on the ministry professionals. You are called to a life of service and ministry and fervent, zealous pursuit of Christ. Don't sell yourself short. Because if you run the race in such a way as to win the prize, I think that prize is worth devoting our time and energies over anything that this life and this world could offer. Let's pray. Father in heaven, so much easier for me to stand up here and talk about this than to live it. So I pray that I would be first and foremost a student of this message. I know that my family, my finances, my health, my life, my comfort often occupy my mind and my time and my focus. But I pray that you would help me to realize that my life is about so much more than the things that I often think about. It's about you. It's about growing in my connection with you. And Lord, I just pray that you would help us to realize that the life that we live down here between the cross and the grave has profound impact. So help us to be wise heavenly IRA investors for your glory and for our enjoyment of your glory forever. In Christ's name, amen.
As we close in response and worship through song, if you're able, please stand and join us as we sing together, "Death Was Arrested." Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Sing, "Ash was redeemed." Now ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. In my orphan heart, was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Let's sing this chorus, "Your grace so free." Oh, your grace so free washes over. I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom He faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and He called me His friend. When death was arrested and my life began, Perfect song to be able to finish out a message specifically talking about treasure, that we can declare how free we are in Christ, and that gift that we have received freely through faith in that salvation, that we still have an opportunity to return dividends on that freedom in the first place. I'm going to read a quick scripture, and then I'll close us in prayer as we dismiss, but I think it is a perfect pairing with the passage that we read in Matthew this morning. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, as Paul is wrapping up his letter to Timothy, he says, "Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed." Let's bow our heads and close in prayer. God, thank you so much that we can celebrate, that we can cheer in your name to be able to be free of the chains and the brokenness and death of sin. I thank you that, God, we can hear in your word and also be challenged to be able to take what you have given us, what you have done for us, and we can take it a step further to be able to truly continue to bring glory to your name. And I pray that that is what we are challenged with, God, that we would seek to store treasures in heaven by bringing you glory and honor and praise forevermore. We thank you, God. Be with us this week as we go to seek your glory and bring it to those around us through that salvation and faith in Jesus Christ. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be dismissed.